We are just starting to hear and see the ripple effects of the GM strike. Linamar, of course, and Magna, some of the auto parts companies here in Canada, downgrading some of their sales, future sales, I want to say. What and how long will we see these ripple effects for?
Well, first of all, the ripple effects are well known. My first paper on the industry 50 years ago documented that one in six jobs in Ontario are tied directly or indirectly to the auto sector. So when you get a major player like General Motors who goes on strike, mind you, it was US, but it did impact on Canada, then the value chain gets affected fairly quickly. I was surprised that it took a few weeks for the Linamars and the Magnus, the suppliers, to respond, talk negatively about it. But nonetheless, it did hit. General Motors will be back up running this week full time. And I suspect the suppliers probably have a little bit of inventory. They may be another week or two before they're back to normal. But we're through it. General Motors negotiated hard. Looks like they got a fair deal for both sides, although the devil's in the details, and most of us don't know the details yet. But it's just part of the auto sector. We've gone through this for decades and decades, and we'll go through another one at some point.
We're still waiting to see what happens with USMCA, and of course the president has to get that in front of Congress. In the meantime, though, there's news coming out of the White House that the White House wants to, I guess, manage trade and production when it comes to their auto sector. So I guess they're trying to force the hand of domestic production. How does this play out for Donald Trump? How does this backfire for the U.S. president?
Well, there's this saying in the auto sector, in fact, in the economic sector, period, is that nobody's more powerful than Adam Smith and his invisible hand. And that's true in the auto sector. They may want to do this kind of thing. There's various politicians over the years have tried to steer investments a little bit, with a little bit of success. But overall, the market determines where vehicles will be built and what vehicles consumers will buy. And you have to be competitive. And so if the US administration pushes the auto sector into being less competitive, then the US auto sector ultimately loses. And the international players who import a fair number of vehicles still into North America will win. And so it's a dumb thing. It's just unfathomable that they can actually direct investments like they're proposing. But then this is a unique US administration. What can you say? It should be something that we fight back on and that we should fear. So fortunately, the NAFTA sets pretty good rules around those things. And hopefully the new USMCA gets ratified. It's kind of like NAFTA light in some respects. And they wouldn't be able to do it under these new terms that hopefully get through Congress and the various political entities out there.
As you mentioned from the onset of this conversation, you've been studying the automotive sector for about 50 years now. We're in a new era.
You bet.
What are some of the biggest challenges as you see them facing Canada's auto sector?
Well, first of all, I like to look at standing on the edge of the industry and looking into the markets. And it's hard to imagine a better era for people buying vehicles. Canadians are now up to about 2 million a year. We used to think 1.5 million was a big deal. North Americans are up to almost 22 million. It's soft by about a million units right now, but that will come back. And so standing on the edge of the industry looking out, I see very little issues. Perhaps the disruptors they talk about, you know, self-driving cars and electric vehicles and ride sharing, those ultimately will have an impact. It's probably towards the end of the next decade, not now. So I don't really have much fear there. Standing on the edge of the industry looking in, the power of Mexico is clear now. They're going to produce 4 million plus vehicles this year. And growing. When I first started in the industry, they were producing about 250,000. And so you think about that. Canada at one point produced a little over 3 million. This year we're well under 2 million, heading down to somewhere south of 1.5 million. We used to have 18% of North American production. Within 3 or 4 years, we'll have about 10% of North American production. We buy 10% of the vehicles in North America. So it's that's not that bad, but it's much worse. And it's the willowing out of the Canadian automotive assembly sector. The parts sector is better off. The parts sector can supply anybody across North America. So whether the vehicles are built in Canada, the US, or Mexico, it matters a little bit. Obviously, better to be in Canada. But good suppliers like the Magnus and Linamars of the world can supply anywhere in North America. And so the suppliers will probably outperform the assembly sector over the next 4 or 5 years in Canada.
You have undoubtedly heard this comparison before. Is Canada's auto sector going to be following the same trajectory as Australia?
Well, the Australia comment is that there is no vehicle manufacturing left in Australia. Everybody has left. They have a smattering of auto parts, but that's it. I don't believe it will, at least in our next 10-year kind of forecast. I think it's politically virtually impossible for any of the five current manufacturers, GM, Ford, FCA, Honda, and Toyota, to completely leave Canada. You saw the ruckus over GM leaving Oshawa, and they're going to be down to just their Cami plant at some point next year. Can you imagine the headlines, people like yourself interviewing the Jerry Dices of the world, and Canada is abandoned by one of the vehicle manufacturers? My own theory is that over the longer term, we end up with five assembly plants. Right now, we have eight. There's two at one. There will be one at GM. There's currently one at Ford. We have two at Chrysler, and I suspect the Brantley plant, longer term, not currently, is vulnerable. How can you produce gas guzzlers and survive in today's climate change? And even Honda and Toyota are reevaluating their two plants each in Canada. Toyota has moved some of their low value-added product out to Mexico, where it belongs. And they're putting higher value-added product in into it. I don't predict any plant closing in the near term. The market's just too strong. They need the production. But longer term, I suspect that we willow out, but we don't become Australia in any way, shape, or form, at least not for the next decade plus. And should we worry beyond that? Probably. But it's so far out that there's a lot of water has to flow under that bridge before we actually have to start to address any vehicle company totally leaving Canada from a production standpoint.